to worship this morning, whether you are here in the sanctuary or with us virtually, welcome to St. John's United Church of Christ. I call your attention to the announcements that are in the bulletin. There are exciting things coming up you need to be aware of. Watch for the food truck, social, VBS coming up, lots of things to do with the church. And speaking of which, thank you to everyone who worked this morning, making sandwiches and packing lunches for Circle of Concern.
Loaves and fishes.
You're right. I beg your pardon. And last week we heard from Pastor Carl Martin about MoVal, and they have a wish list. And that's available through News Notes. And if you bring something for the MoVal wish list, there's a table for that downstairs in the fellowship hall. Next week and the week following, I will be on vacation. And leading worship and preaching will be Reverend Susan King. And she is a frequent speaker at local churches. And besides that, is a chaplain at Mercy Hospital. And so I think that you will enjoy hearing her next week. A reminder again to put your presents in the friendship pad. They are in the center. And so after you've put your information, pass it down so other people in your pew can put their presents here. It is important to note who is here. We are the people that make up the body of Christ this morning. So I invite you to turn and greet one another and pass the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us prepare our hearts for the worship of God. to right paths. Hear the voice that continually calls, leads, and stays with us. Life in the Spirit is constantly renewed and restored. Let the grace of God nurture our roots and allow our flourishing. Amen. Jesus. So we have to learn to let go so that we can go with Jesus. Let's pray. God, help us let go. We want to follow Jesus, and so we ask your help to let go of anger and greed and any excess baggage that we carry with us. Amen.
Luke chapter 9, verses 51 through 62. When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he sent his messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. But they did not receive him because his face was set towards Jerusalem. When his disciples James and John saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes, and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." And another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home. Jesus said to him, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." Here ends the reading. May God and his blessings add his blessings to the reading and hearing of the scriptures.
Thanks be to God.
I have heard that one of the largest religious groups in this country today are the nuns. And no, I'm not talking about the religious Catholic women that are part of an order, but N-O-N-E-S. You know, there are times when you're asked to fill out a form, and on that form it asks for what is your religion. And so you might write Catholic, or you might write United Church of Christ, or Baptist, but a major portion of the population this day writes none on that line. And that category could actually be broken down further into the nuns and the nones. The nuns are those who have not given up on their faith. They believe in God, but they have given up on any organized religion, and so they write none. The other group, the nones, usually a much smaller group, have no faith. They will tell you that they are agnostic or that they are atheists. Much of the world has given up on organized religion. And I just had a thought that maybe that is somewhat related to today's text, and the fact that in today's text, it gives you another whole category of people. It wouldn't fit on the line when you fill out the form, but this group might be called the people with very excellent excuses. The people that Jesus speaks with seem quite ready to believe and respond when Jesus says, "Follow me." They intend to respond eventually. But right now, they have some very excellent excuses. They had other things that they felt they wanted to take care of first before they could follow Jesus, which meant that Jesus' invitation was never more than second in their priorities. One said, "Sure, I'll follow you, but let me first go and bury my father." And another said, "Oh, absolutely, I'm with you, but let me go and say farewell to those at home before we start out." On the surface, those seem like eminently reasonable excuses. They're excellent excuses for waiting a bit, you would think, to take care of an aging father, or to put one's affairs in order and the family affairs in order before taking off. I suspect, however, that these responses are actually good escape lines. The sort we use when we're trying to back out of a sales transaction when we find out it's more expensive than we thought. We've expressed some real interest in the product, but when the salesman tries to close the deal, we begin to have second thoughts. And at that point, I say, "Oh, sure, I'll be back, but first I have to go and talk to my husband about this." And that salesperson probably knows that I don't ever intend to show my face again. And we can't be too critical of these wannabe disciples, because as Jesus knew, real discipleship is demanding. And it takes a lot for a spur-of-the-moment impulse to become a lifetime commitment. Jesus realized that and warned one of them that we heard of in today's text, one who was making the decision lightly, perhaps. Jesus said, "Foxes have holes and birds have their nests, but I have no place to lay my head." Jesus knew following him would not be easy. But still, it sounds harsh when Jesus says, "Let the dead bury the dead." Jesus' harshness is partially justified by a certain psychological phenomena of an emotion becoming a substitute for real action. For instance, when I feel sympathy for a friend who has lost a loved one, but don't get around to ever actually calling or sending a note expressing my sympathy, and yet somehow feel like I have done enough, I have thought of the person. Thoughts and prayers are good, but they are not a substitute for doing something that is within your power to do. So Jesus' response to these excellent excuses tells us that his disciples need to be focused on what lies ahead and not what is behind them. You can't put your hand to the plow and turn and look back and plow a straight line or expect to be a good disciple. How one reacts to Jesus' call says a lot about priorities and unconditional commitment. Jesus was telling them to decide, what is your main thing? And if following Jesus is the main thing, then put him first over top of whatever else was clamoring for attention. Jesus said the same thing in different words recorded in the Gospel of Matthew, saying, "Strive first for the kingdom of God and God's righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." First, one must make a one-time decision that they will strive to put God's call first in their lives. And then following becomes a daily conversation, a journey with him that flows out of a relationship with God and God's Son. All the minor and major decisions will flow out of that relationship if you are one of those who has heard Christ's invitation. And so then, if you are one who has given some excellent excuses, we are given a chance to reconsider. The road to which Jesus calls us hasn't gotten any easier, but the way is still right. Amen. Would you stand if you are able as we sing, "I Have Decided to Follow Jesus"?
I have decided to follow Jesus.
none. We bring to you our prayers for all your people, for all whom we love, and those for whom we watch and care. For Paul, Tim, Betty, Shirley, AJ. For all who have asked us to pray for them. For Ukraine. For Italy and the people of Italy. For those who attempt to cross the sea from Africa to Europe. For those who must flee their homes, that they would encounter acts of kindness, and that in time their trauma will be healed. For all who have no one to pray for them. For all prisoners and captives, all who suffer from oppression, and for those who are the oppressors. For all who suffer, the sick in body or mind. For all those who are troubled by the sin or suffering of those they love. For all who are grieving. For all who are absorbed in their own sorrows, that they may be inspired to share the sorrows of others. For all who are lonely and sad in the midst of others' joy, that they may know you as their friend and comforter. For the infirm and aged, and for all who are passing through the valley of death, that they may find their strength in you and light at evening time. We pray for all who are forgotten by us, but dear to you, loving God. We ask you to watch over them all and to make us channels of your grace. Stir within us a yearning to be more than we are, and create in us an enthusiasm so burning that others might see the light of Jesus. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to say these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done.
Child's Hope says this: partnering with the community to assist children, youth, and their families in their unique pursuit of health and wholeness through quality, professional, and faithful services. So what does that mean to us? Some key words in this mission statement begin with the concept that we are assisting clients, and if you will, we are in service and support of their pursuit for health and wholeness. Children and families at ECH are on their own journeys, and our job is to serve and guide them to seek the right path for their well-being. We use the word faithful because we try to do this in a way that is faithful to God and is His example of servant leadership, humility, compassion, support, and love for others. And then finally, we do this through the delivery of professional services. This means, in addition to being servant leaders and following the example of Jesus, we need to be informed. We need to know what we're doing so that we can guide people in ways that are helpful to them on their life's journey. It strikes me as Reverend Lisa was talking in the children's portion this morning about letting go. Most and much of what we do at ECH is helping people let go of past hurts and move on constructively with their lives. ECH is now in the 164th year of its operation. From the moment that our founder, Reverend Louis Nolisle, said to his congregation, "We have all we need, we have the children," and founded Every Child's Hope in 1858, the agency has demonstrated an unshakable faithfulness to the mission of caring for vulnerable children and families. And we live this mission out and ministry out in several different ways. And I'm just going to highlight a few of the things that are going on at ECH today that lives out the mission in 2022. We serve 30 children in what we call residential treatment. These are children who have been traumatized and have had hurts that they need to figure out how to let go and move on with. Many times they have severe mental health issues and behavioral challenges. They're angry children because they've been harmed. This is the legacy service of the agency, because you know we started as an orphanage. And we've served literally thousands and thousands of children on our campus on the Rock Road. This is also a time of exciting transformation for our residential program. So we have buildings on our campus that we call historical. That's code word for old, beat up, and they need to be replaced. So we're on this journey, and the Brandons are a big part of this. I know they're here this morning and helping us. We decided to really work well with our children who have these traumas. We need to build a new facility. So we are on a capital campaign journey. We've raised over $6.2 million to build a new facility for our children. Facilities they're in now are 70 years old, and they've done their time, and they've been of great service, but it's time to move on. So we've raised $6.2 million. We are actually building a new facility on our campus. I look out the window every day, and I count how many workers are out there every morning, and we hope the facility will be completed I always add a month to everything they tell me, so probably March of next year. It's an 18,000 square foot building. It's a youth development center for these children who will live there with us and hopefully be there to heal and get better. In addition to that, we have all kinds of other services. We have an early ed center where you do early Head Start and Head Start service. The idea being to get to children and families early so we can hopefully help them avoid the traumas that our children that have to be in our facility have had. We have a specialized school on our campus that helps children with their challenges. And we have a foster care case management system where you may not know that we serve over 238 children across the state of Missouri that are living in foster homes, pre-adoptive homes, other families' homes, to help them find a place to live where they can have permanent living arrangements in their communities. We're in Jefferson City, we're in St. Louis County, we're now in southeast Missouri, so we've kind of spread our imprint across the state of Missouri. So on any one day, at this point in our history, ECH serves over 1,000 children in some part of our program. We do that when we're fully staffed with about 195 staff. I will tell you, besides the pandemic, which hopefully we're moving through, the other huge challenge at our point, I hope you guys will say prayers for us, just like everybody else, we're having a hard time with workforce. We have workforce challenges. And so we're staffed down and staffed short, and that's a concern sometimes to take care of our children. But it takes a great commitment from our staff to provide the types of caring and unwavering support that many of our children and family need on a daily basis. In training, I tell staff that they need to have a long-term view of the impact on the clients that they're working with on a daily basis, because the fruit of their labor may not be evident in the short term. Our kids don't usually every day say, well, you're so wonderful to us. They don't do that necessarily, and my kids didn't either, as a matter of fact. But I tell them that your reward maybe will come in heaven, and I think it will. So on behalf of those staff, of all the children we serve, our board of directors, I want to thank you for allowing me to be here this morning and share our ministries with you and for your support. Thank you so much.
This morning is a particularly good example of this church's involvement in mission, including Every Child's Hope and the others that we've already mentioned this morning. We have those kind of opportunities to give through the church, as well as supporting the church itself so that we can be here and worship together. So to celebrate our giving now and to dedicate those gifts, I invite you to stand as we sing the doxology. May we go in grace and peace to discover the joy of following and joining in the work of Jesus Christ, finding him among the broken of this world. Amen.